everyone. Welcome to our Becoming Your Mom support group. We have some visitors with us today. Welcome to you. My name is Mark, and I'm the group leader. And I think we'll start by reciting our mission statement. We love our moms, but we are not our moms.
We love our moms, but we are not our moms.
Carol, would you mind starting us off this week?
Hi, everyone. I'm Carol.
Hi, Carol.
I am the oldest of three roommates, and I'm turning into my mom. I clean up everything after them. I've even started doing their laundry.
I talk to myself in the grocery store all the time.
All of my status updates are just pictures of kids. I don't even have kids.
Same. Well, kids and recipes.
The other day, I almost licked my finger and wiped the face of a total stranger.
I keep saying words like garbage and Tarjay. What is that?
I'll send a text to someone just to let them know I sent them an email.
Well, how else would they know?
Right?
I mean, these shoes were on sale. What am I supposed to do? Not buy them?
I call my husband my son's name. And sometimes I call my son the dog's name.
I always tell people, I'll be like 2 minutes, then it'll be like an hour.
Whoa, whoa, take it easy there. Shannon already has a tissue. We really don't need to offer her one.
I do.
Did you see how they let the momness overtake them? So you may not be able to avoid becoming your mom, but the key is to let the beautiful things about moms shine through in your life. The kindness, the caring, the compassion, the qualities that God gave moms when He created them.
Oh, like when I text my friends, LOL, lots of love?
That's not what LOL means.
That's what my son told me it meant.
LOL, lots of love. What else would it mean?
You know, I used to be an amazing dancer. Now when I dance, people just get embarrassed. Can I show you?
Yeah. Oh, no, Carol. Carol, sit down.
Oh, it's not bad.
Carol, please. One, two.
Good morning and welcome to St. Andrew's Sunday morning service. And we're so glad you could join us here today. We have an announcement that we would like to share with you. This week, we sent out a letter to everybody talking about how we're going to reopen the church when that glorious day finally gets here. And inside the letter is a response card that we would like for you to fill out and send back to us so we can sort of organize and get our plan together. So now we're all going to join together in our call to worship. We've come to worship God, who loved us before we were born, who knows us better than we know ourselves, whose presence never leaves us, and whose love for us never ceases.
This is our God. Let's worship together.
Jewel to give
our affirmation of faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, saints of the church. It's Mother's Day, and it's a great day, a beautiful day. And I invite you, if you would, just to join with me in a moment of prayer, and let us pray. Oh, Holy God, we give you thanks for the day that we have come to and the beauty of it. Lord, we also thank you this day for the beauty of mothers, those who have loved us and cared for us, nurtured us, and lifted us up when we were bruised and when we were down. Those who have said soothing words to us when pain seemed to just almost overwhelm us. And in those moments of growing, Lord God, when we didn't know who else to turn to, we turned to our mothers and we shared our burdens. And our mothers so often just would touch our forehead, whisper something, and it seemed like all was right with the world once again. God, you are also like that. You are so often like a mother to us. You birthed this world, this creation. You knew us before we were formed in our mother's womb because we were already inside of you and a part of you. And Lord God, so often you too have come to soothe us, to listen to us when we're hurt and we're complaining and the different things that go on in our life. Oh Lord God, we give you thanks that there are those moments when you have been like a mother to us with all your love and your care. Lord God, right now your earth and your creation needs that hand upon us. That motherly, loving hand to soothe the pain that we're feeling, the life journey that we are on, and all of the experiences that are going on around us. Lord, we're frightened. We're frightened of a coronavirus. We are frightened, Lord God, about jobs and our children and their future. So we need your soothing hand and that warm embrace that only you can bring to us. So, Lord God, we pray on this Sunday that we can experience you in that way. So come now, Lord God, and wrap your arms around us, hold us, love us, and reassure us that you're going to be here for our journey. And Lord God, we also lift ourselves up to you, knowing that we are sinful. We've not done all that we should in our life. Lord, forgive us for our shortcomings. And help us, Lord, that when opportunities present themselves to do good, that we might step into that role and live it out so that we too can make a difference in this world in which we live. Oh, gracious God, this is our prayer we have on this beautiful Sunday. And we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we approach our moment of offering today, I lift you up. I want to lift you up to God because you are a beautiful offering in this way. You do so much for the kingdom by the way you live your life, the way you're helping each other, nurturing each other. We have that group of people in the church who call one another just to be sure you're all right. Those who have mowed lawns and brought meals are just given a good word or a wave when they pass by on their bicycle. You know, these are all wonderful offerings. Of course, so many of you have been faithful to the offering of your gifts to the church as well. So whatever your offering is to God's kingdom and to Christ's ministry through the church and in your neighborhood and community, I give thanks for it, and I invite you to pray with me as we offer whatever our offering is to God. Lord God, bless whatever it is, however we are offering to you. May it be through our sacrifices of time and energy, our gifts of our being, or simply, Lord God, the monies that we have to offer. May it all be blessed by you, and we pray that in your Son's holy name. Amen.
just believe. Oh, many dangers, toils, and stress I have already safely come. This grace hath brought me safe thus far.
From Matthew 15, verses 21 through 28, the New American Standard Bible version. Jesus went away from there and withdrew into the district of Tyre and Sidon. And a Canaanite woman from that region came out and began to cry out, saying, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is cruelly demon-possessed." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and implored him, saying, "Send her away, because she keeps shouting at us." But he answered and said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and began to bow down before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered and said, "It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." But she said, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs feed on the crumbs which fall from their master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "O woman, your faith is great. It shall be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed at once. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Marcy, for the reading of the Scripture. And let us pray. Lord God, bless this reading of the Scripture and help us, Lord God, to internalize its meaning into our life. And may the message I'm about to share, Lord God, speak to each and every one of us as you would have it speak. And we ask that in Jesus' name, amen. This is Mother's Day, and you know, one of the great things in the life of our church is that we ask people to send pictures of their mothers to us. And then we put them together in a video. So I want you to watch this video now.
night with a screaming baby. You run all day at the speed of life, and every day you feel a little bit less like the beautiful woman you are. So you fall into bed when you run out of hours, and you wonder if anything worth doing got done. Or maybe you just don't know, or maybe you forgot. You are changing the world, one little heartbeat at a time, making history with every touch and every smile. Oh, you may not see it now, but I believe that time will tell how you change in the world, one little heartbeat at a time. I know you can do it. Every tear that you kiss away, so many little things that seem to go unnoticed, they're just like the drops of rain over time. They become a river, and you are changing. Time, making history with every touch and every smile. Oh, you may not see it now, but I believe that time will tell how you change in the world, one little heartbeat at a time.
Wasn't that a great video? I want to thank Lindsay for preparing it for us, and I do appreciate it very much. You know, there are a lot of people who have that mother role in our life. Sometimes it can be a father, where father has to be both mom and dad to a child. I've been in that role. Others have. It could be a grandparent, an older sibling. There are a lot of people who are in that role, and for whoever you are, if you've been in that sort of mothering, nurturing role to someone else, we thank you. You know, over the years of my life, I've learned some things about being a parent. And some of the lessons I've learned were extremely painful, and some were very easy. But this is one I'll never forget, and I'll just tell it to you like this. Never underestimate the persistence and the power of a woman, a mother that is, who's standing up and protecting her child. That was the lesson Jesus learned today in the story that Marcy read to you. There's this woman who's come to Jesus, and she's asking Jesus, said, Jesus, I want you to heal my child. And she's praying to him, beseeching him. Jesus is kind of like a man of that time, and he ignores her first, and then he insults her. Ultimately, what he ends up doing is healing her child. But it's also a story of a woman who's determined, and she's persistent, and she's not going to give up because her child needs help, And so she is right there after Jesus, just saying, help, help, help. You know, that first reading of that, Jesus doesn't come off very good, does he? It doesn't really sound like the Jesus we know. But let's consider a few things here for a moment. At that point in his life, he's been busy doing, you know, a Messiah sort of thing in his life. He has been teaching, praying, healing, helping the sick, raising the dead. He has been in conflict with church leaders of his time, feeding the multitudes. He's wore out. I mean, he is wore out and he's famished. And so what he's going to do is he's going to go off for a while. And that's what he wanted to do. Now, in the Gospel of Mark, it reads it like this. Jesus and his disciples went to the vicinity of Tyre and entered a house, and they didn't want anyone to know. Why would they enter a house and not want anyone to know? He's on vacation. And when you're on vacation, you don't want to be bothered. And Jesus is taking a weekend off. Just he wants to be left alone. Now, Tyre itself is a pretty interesting little city. It took Jesus 3 days to walk there from where he had been. It was about a 35-mile walk. And Tyre is located on the edge of the Mediterranean Sea. It's a town where Greeks and Canaanites and Syrophoenician people gathered, the wealthy. It was a wealthy area. It wasn't a Jewish town. There weren't any Jews there. So, yeah, for him, it was a great place to get away. He's thinking to himself, I'm going to go here. Nobody will know me. Nobody will know me. And I get a weekend off. It doesn't work that way for him. Not very well. So let me ask, how about you? Have you ever gone somewhere and you thought to yourself, you know, I could get away from people. Nobody will know me here. And sure enough, you ran into somebody. Story. My children, when they were 6, 9, and 12, I took them up to the area called Columbia Glaciers up in Canada. It's about a 5-hour drive north of Banff, so it's really a long ways up there. And we got up there. We got backcountry permits. We were going to go hiking and camping in the backcountry. So we got all packed up, and we went, and it's very, they have it very strict. You know, only so many people can go, and you have to stay in this campsite or this campsite. So we get to where we're going that first night, and we get our little pup tent up and our fire, and we're cooking dinner. And walking by us is a group of young ladies, and they go on to the next little site not far away. So after dinner, we thought we'd do camp politeness, and we went over to introduce ourselves. So if they need anything or we might need anything, you know, we'd know who each other was. And so walked up, and we introduced ourselves and said we were from the States. And they said, well, we're from the States. I said, well, we're from Louisiana. They said, we're from Louisiana. And I said, we're from New Orleans. They were from New Orleans. I said, we're in East New Orleans. And they were in East New Orleans. And I said, we live on Ninth Street. And they told me where they live. They live catacorner behind us there in New Orleans. You know, I didn't go all that way to meet people that live by me. But that's sort of what happened to Jesus in this story, right? So here he is. He's checking into that resort side town. And he's going to his room that he's going to have. And as he's walking up there, all of a sudden he hears this voice. Jesus, Jesus, hey, is that you, Jesus? Jesus, wait for me for a moment. Jesus, hey, Jesus, Jesus. And you know what he does? He does one of these things. He's pretending he doesn't know or he doesn't hear. Have you ever done that before? You've been so tired, so worn out in your life that you kind of like pretended you didn't hear anybody? Hey, guys, how's that working out with your wives? Exactly. It doesn't work out when you ignore them that way, and it didn't work out for Jesus at that moment. He pretends, but it doesn't work. Well, maybe there's an explanation here that we can pull into for a moment. See, ignoring that woman is something that sort of happens in Tyre in this sense. The Jewish people and the people of Tyre see each other sort of like bitter enemies. They don't like each other. Tyre is that wealthy place. And in Syrophoenicia, the Jews live over here in Nazareth, and they cultivate the fields, and they get the food together. Then they bring that food to Tyre, and the people there don't pay fair wages. They're not nice to them. They insult them. They talk down to them. So Jesus is walking into this town, first thinking no one knows him. Then the Syrophoenician woman is yelling at him, Jesus, stop. You wait for me, Jesus. And maybe his ignoring her is saying, you know, you're not going to talk to me like that. I'm not going to put up with that. And so he keeps going, maybe not. And the woman, though, what does she do? She gives him the benefit of the doubt, like, he didn't really hear me. So she tries again. And she starts to yell out, and she's being persistent. Moms have a way of doing that. Being persistent. Staying on. I want this for my child. I desire this for my child. And Jesus, you're the only one that can do it. I'm not going to let you walk away from me. You are going to help me. And the disciples at this moment are frustrated. And they're getting between Jesus and this woman, kind of like body blockers there, just, you know, doing this. And some of them are touching Jesus and they say, Jesus, do something. She won't be quiet. She won't leave us alone. Help us out. And so in the Gospel of Mark, Jesus said this, I have been sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. Wow. I mean, you know, that wasn't a really nice thing to say. You kind of look at him and say, I don't get that. And then you realize that's really not true. In just about a couple weeks from now, Jesus is going to be at his ascension. He's going into heaven. And do you remember what he says to all the disciples gathered in Galilee? He said this to them. He said, go ye into all of the world and tell them about me. He didn't say just the Jewish world. And the centurion, he healed the centurion's servant. He wasn't Jewish. And the Gerasene demonic was the Gentile that he healed. So we know that this is a little out of kilter at this moment for Jesus. But so now twice, what has Jesus done? He's ignored the woman. But she's a mom. Her daughter is sick. Jesus ought to know by this moment, he is not going to win it. Not this one. Nope, it's not going to happen that way. And so in Matthew chapter 15, the woman now kneels before Jesus. And she says to him, Lord, help me. And then Jesus says this to her, it is not good to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Wow. I mean, that's not like a Jesus moment, is it? I mean, who ever thought of Jesus saying something like that? I don't know. You know, if you look at the Greek word that he uses for dogs there, it doesn't mean mud. It means something like a lap dog, a fuzzy little pet, sort of like more like a pet, cute little pet. I don't know that softens it in any way. But maybe what his response was, you know, I'm going to treat you the way your people treat us Jews. And so he disrespected her. So what does the woman do? This is it. She looks at him and says, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall off the master's table. Wow. I mean, you talk about a zinger. She got in there. I mean, what is Jesus going to say to even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall off the master's table? I mean, there is no comeback for that. He's kind of like, And you know what he says to her? He said, woman, you got great faith, and your daughter will be healed. Well, you know, in the Jesus story, if you pull back the leaves a little and you dig further down, you find something else is really going on. And it's a complicated story, but there's a whole lot more going on here with Jesus. And I think it's this, some of this. Okay, Jesus knew why he was going to Tyre. I mean, he absolutely knew why he was going there. And the reason I think that is I realized that he knew that Peter would deny him. Judas would betray him. He even said, you know, you tear down this temple and I'll build it back up in 3 days. And over again, you see him telling the future, knowing what he was going to do and how he was going to do it. So I think he went to Tyre knowing he was going to encounter this woman. I really do. So he's going there to encounter her. And I don't think it was just for her sake. It wasn't just to heal her daughter, maybe say to the Phoenicians, hey, look who I am. I'm going to be God of all people. I think it was for the disciples. So they would write it down. We'd know about it. But maybe even more importantly, it's for you and me. So let's go back over the scene for a moment. You have this woman and she's praying to Jesus. That's her petition. Lord Jesus, help me. Help my child. Please, I want her well. I want her well. So she's making a petition, and then over here he finally grants it. But in between, there's this great gulf of silence. He ignores her. He puts her down. He doesn't have anything to do with it. It's silence. Well, this is what Adam Hamilton says about it. He says, speaking of this story, there are times in our lives when God is silent. And in those moments between the time we ask and the time we receive is where God is at work. There are times in our life when God is silent. Between the time we pray to God and the time we get the answer. And it's in those moments God is at work. And he goes on. By seeming to ignore that woman and saying, I've come for the lost sheep, what Jesus is doing is calling forth something inside of her. He's calling forth perseverance, a faith, a determination in her. He knows what he's going to do already. Now, something is beginning to well up inside of this woman in the midst of his three-time denial. And until she gives her brilliant answer and shows her great faith, he's not willing to do anything. And then it happens. You see, Jesus pushing her to discover that he wasn't just a miracle worker. He wasn't some sideshow to a circus. That he was the Messiah. And he deliberately doesn't do something there. But yet something is happening. Something's happening inside of her. She's growing in faith until finally he knows that she's arrived. And when she's arrived and saw him as the Messiah, then he healed her daughter. You know, in all of our lives, there are these moments where we pray for our children. I pray for mine. You pray for yours. And we're not sure when the answer is going to come. We pray for someone else, but still, the answer is somewhere down here. And it seems like just nothing's happening with God. Nothing's happening with God. And we're just so desperately waiting for something. But God's doing something. So when I was a child, growing up in South Texas, the elementary school I went to didn't have air conditioning. None of our schools had air conditioning in the 50s and 60s. It wasn't there. They had the windows open. I'll just tell you a little bit about me. My poor parents, they prayed for me all the time. Oh my gosh, they had to pray for me all the time. Because I was the most distracted student in the entire class. Birds would fly in because the windows were down. You know, lizards would come in. Bees would come in. And as soon as anything came in that room, I jumped up to catch it. And the teacher always say, sit down, Tommy, sit down, Tommy. No, I'd catch it. I could catch a bee in my hand. It wouldn't sting me. I wouldn't do it today, but back then I could. Take it outside. I'd put frogs in my pocket. I just couldn't sit still any length of time. And I still have that problem greatly to this very day. So a test would come along, and I'd be distracted by the person's pencil next to me or whatever it was. And I wouldn't do good. So towards the end of the year, I was in danger of failing. And I didn't know it too much later in life. But what my mother would do was go up there. She'd talk to the teacher and say, would you put Tommy in a private room where there's no other desk, there is no window, just you and him and the test. He knows it. We've tutored him. We've worked with him. Please do this. He knows everything. He just gets distracted. And you know what? They did some things like that. Maybe not quite to that degree, but they would allow me to do it again and again, and I would pass. My mom's and dad's prayer was this, that one day I'd be successful. My mom lived to see it. My dad didn't. But all along the way, mom helped. And what I didn't realize it was that she was my stretcher bearer. A stretcher bearer is the person who comes along beside you and carries you and helps you in those times of your need, and you don't know it. They walk up and they bump up against you and they help you. Now, when my dad died, times were rough. I didn't really realize how rough they were for my mom. You don't realize that at that age. But we always had food on the table. And we had creative leftovers. Oh my gosh, mom could do almost anything with leftovers, so it tasted like a new meal. In those times, this is what I remember. At night, my mom would read her Bible. Sundays, we'd go to church. We'd go to Sunday school. And she made sure I was in youth group. She was always there, and she was faithful to it. She was going through some real hard times. And people would come to our house, and they would help things, like they would fix the fence, or they would work on my car, teach me how to do something with the air conditioner. There were people who would come up beside my mom. They were her stretcher bearers. And what I begin to notice as I look back now is that mom took a spiritual lift from them. What they were doing, and the reason they were doing it, was feeding into my mom and giving her a lift and giving her spirit and giving her hope that she didn't have and that she had lost at one point in her life. She felt that and she saw it. So that translated later in life for her. From this prayer when Dad dies, how am I going to make it? How am I going to raise Tommy? What am I going to do? To this place of almost fruition, I would call it. When she was 91, it was her last trip down here. She'd been living in Albuquerque, and my sister brought her to Weatherford, Texas, where I would meet her. So they did that 10-hour drive, and I would go up there. Weatherford's on the other side of Dallas-Fort Worth. And I would bring her from there down to here, and that'd take 9 or 10 hours because of all the stops we had to make. Well, on this last trip, It was during the time of Advent. And as we were driving up here, it was on a Wednesday night. And as we were driving by the church, Mom said, "What's going on at the church? What's going on at the church?" I was kind of in a hurry to get back. And I said, "Well, Mom, tonight is a special mission night. We've collected all of these items. We're going to put them into bags. And we're going to make bags. And we're going to give them to the homeless." And she said, "Well, let's go." And I said, "Well, don't you want me to take you to the house and unpack you?" And she goes, "No, let's go." And so we came right to the church that night, walked in. And some of you might remember that after dinner, Mom got up. She had her bag. And she put the socks in there. She put the mittens in there. And she put the headscarf in there. And she did that. And the reason was, she knew what it meant to be a stretcher bearer for someone else to walk along and help them during that hard time of life. Because that was the presence of God as she understood it and as I understood it in my life. Now, I think that's how God works. A lot of times we're in persistent prayer to God and we bug God a lot with our prayers over and over and over again. And we say, "Lord, what about my child? And what about me? Are you going to do something?" And along that journey, before that answer comes, sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not what we want. People walk up beside us. Recently, a Georgia Ford called me and was talking to me, and she said, "There's somebody that she knew, I don't remember who it was at all." She said, "You know, I'm wondering if it'd be okay if we got some people to mow their lawn." And I said, "Yeah, I bet it would be. Just let them know that we're going to do that." She asked me, "Who should we call?" And we kind of talked, and then she said, "Oh, I how about one of the guys on our mowing team?" I said, "Would you do that, Georgia?" I kind of put it back on her a little bit. And you know what she did? And that lawn got mowed. And I think, wow, that's what it means to be a stretcher bearer, is to enable others to do things, sometimes to ask them to do things. You know, that's what we're all called to do, is to walk up beside someone who needs some spiritual affirmation in their life. But on Mother's Day, especially a parent or a child, because you can look at them sometimes and you look and you say, they're hurting. They have needs. They're not able to bear the load. And somebody is needed to step in at that moment. I think about Brenda Redpath in our church. She's a CASA volunteer and a nurse on the front lines right now. Through her ministry with children and families, you know, a difference is being made. And that's what we're all called to do, is to be God's hand, to give people strength when they need it. Sometimes to be just that listening ear to someone or to be a helping hand. So this is what I want to say to moms and dads right now and grandparents. You know, we pray. And sometimes that answer isn't just like right there. Sometimes it takes a while. But between those two places where you think God is silent in your life, look at who's helping. Sometimes it's you helping the child. Are your parents reaffirming you? Or someone that you don't know has just come up into your life? And in that process, your faith starts to grow. That's how it happens, and that's how it works. So here's what I want you to walk away with today. Be persistent. Be absolutely persistent. Do not give up on your children. Children, do not give up on your parents. You pray for them. You keep loving them. You care for them, no matter how frustrating they may get. Because that day may come when that prayer, "Lord, heal us," will happen. I have some friends right now. They and their child have been estranged for many years. And I have prayed with this family, and they have prayed that something would happen. And recently, their child reached out to them. And now, even though it's tenuous, they're having that conversation. Healing is happening. They didn't give up. So don't give up. Always be persistent. You know, God likes persistence. God doesn't mind being bugged because things are happening between then and here. So do that. Second thing, don't be in a hurry to make your kids grow up. Your kid is 3 years old. Why are you talking about Harvard? You shouldn't be. You should be looking and enjoying your three-year-old. You know what you do with a child? You want to really have fun? Instead of worrying about what's next in their life, lay down in the grass with your child. You know, get a piece of straw or something. Start chewing on it. Lay on your back. Look at the clouds in the sky and start pointing out, "Hey, that looks like a dinosaur. That looks like a heart." Enjoy the moments of your child. Don't be in such a hurry that all of a sudden one day it's gone and you go, where did it go to? Be persistent. Love your child. Experience your child's life with them. And then finally this. God calls all of us to walk along beside moms and dads and children, especially families where there aren't moms right now, or mom can't be there in their life, or mom's not fully present there. We need to walk along beside them. You see, that's what Jesus is asking you to do. Walk with somebody. Be with them. And that's really our mission. It really is. The mission of the church and the mission of the Christian. To walk along beside somebody. To be a stretcher bearer. Because you are part of the answer to their prayer. You are God's hands in their life. Thanks be to God. And let us pray. Oh Lord God, I pray for us on this day that each one of us might just open up our heart and say, Lord, let me be that person that you tap to walk up to someone else, that I might be part of that activity you're doing between the prayer asked and the answer given, and that through who we are, Lord God, and our presence in those people's life, that they might be able to have spiritual strength given to them, spiritual wisdom, and really, Lord God, just understand, wow, you're making a difference. Help us to be those people, Lord God, for we pray this in your Son's most holy name. Amen. And now we're going to hear our choir as they sing to us our final hymn of the day. Church, I hope that you have enjoyed and appreciated this Mother's Day service, and that each of you are blessed and have an opportunity to maybe FaceTime with your moms or call them or talk to them in some way, or that mom figure in your life. Whatever it is, I just pray that this day is be a blessing for you. So receive this benediction. And now may you be blessed by God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And may God wrap his arms around you and hold you this day. And may you always know that he walks with you. And I pray this in his name. Amen.